गुड मॉर्निंग एवरी वन, टुडे आई विल टेक योर क्लास ऑन चाइल्डहुड एस्थमा. सो हाउ डू यू डिफाइन एस्थमा? एस्थमा इज़ अ क्रॉनिक इन्फ्लेमेटरी डिजीज ऑफ द लंग एयरवेज कैरेक्टराइज्ड बाय एयरवे हाइपर रिस्पॉन्सिवनेस टू अ वैरायटी ऑफ स्टिमुलाई रिजल्टिंग इन रिवर्सिबल एयर फ्लो ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन. तो दीज थ्री कीवर्ड्स आर इम्पॉर्टेंट. इट इज़ अ क्रॉनिक इन्फ्लेमेटरी डिजीज which is characterized by airway hyper-responsiveness and it results in reversible airflow obstruction. So when does asthma begins? It begins by 1 year of age in 26% of the patients, between 1 year to 5 years in 51% of the cases, and after 5 years in 22% of the cases. So cumulatively, 77% of asthma begins in children less than 5 years of age. So you should remember that asthma often begins in early childhood. Coming to the etiopathogenesis, what is the etiology of asthma? So three factors play an important role in the etiology: environmental factors, age of the child, and genetic factors. A combination of environmental and genetic factors in early life. So environmental factors, biological factors in early life, they shape how the immune system develops and responds to ubiquitous environmental exposures. In the susceptible host, immune system responds to common immune system responds to common airway exposures and stimulate prolonged pathogenic inflammation in the airways. Plus, there is aberrant repair. There is aberrant repair of these injured airways, resulting in lung dysfunction and airway remodeling. So these pathogenic processes in the growing lung during early life leads to altered airways at mature ages. So I hope you have understood three factors: environmental factors, genetic factors, and age of the child. They shape how the immune system develops and when it is exposed to environmental exposures, they stimulate prolonged inflammation, resulting in aberrant repair of the injured airways and airway remodeling. What are the early childhood risk factors for persistent asthma? The most important major risk factors for development of persistent asthma are parental asthma, history of asthma in the parents, plus history of atopy. So these are the main factors. If there is presence of parental asthma or there is history of atopy in the child itself, how does atopy present? It can present as atopic dermatitis, allergic rhinitis, or food allergy. So if these are present, the child has a greater chances for development of persistent asthma in later life. Apart from these, there is certain risk factors are like male gender, low birth weight, environmental tobacco smoke exposure, etc. There are certain triggers, asthma triggers. So when these triggers are present, they can be certain viral pathogens or certain environmental allergens, which can trigger the immune system of a susceptible host to have an exacerbation of asthma. What are the common triggers? You can see dust, pollen of the plants, animal dander, cockroaches, mold, cold and dry air, smoke, exercise, cigarette smoke, etc. What happens in asthma? This is the normal bronchial tree, and this is bronchial tree in an asthmatic patient. In smaller airways, airflow is regulated by the smooth muscles which encircle the lumen of the airways. When they contract, they result in bronchoconstriction. This bronchoconstriction blocks the airway. So one mechanism is that there is bronchoconstriction of the smooth muscles of the airways and it causes airway obstruction. However, the main component is, as you can see, inflammation of the airways. The main component is inflammation, chronic inflammation of the airways. So what happens, there is a cellular inflammatory infiltrate and exudate which is predominated by eosinophils. It fills and obstructs the airways. It induces epithelial damage, shedding of the epithelium which desquamates into the lumen. So again, all this causes blockage of the airway. So this is just an overview of the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system to help you understand. The sympathetic nervous system, in the lungs, the receptors are beta-2 receptors, and these receptors, they cause bronchodilation. So when there is activation of these beta-2 receptors, it causes bronchodilation. So beta-2 receptor agonists will cause bronchodilation. This you should keep in mind. The second system is parasympathetic system, in which the muscarinic receptors of the lungs, it causes bronchoconstriction. So if we give antagonist to these muscarinic receptors, there will be bronchodilation, and this will help in the treatment of asthma. So like this, beta-2 receptor agonists and muscarinic or anticholinergics, muscarinic receptors antagonists, they help in treatment of asthma. So what happens when you don't treat asthma well? This is a normal bronchial tube. This is an inflamed one in asthma. So when it is partly treated, some bronchodilation occurs, but ultimately airway remodeling occurs and it leads to a narrow tube. In what is airway remodeling? In airway remodeling, there is permanent structural changes in the airway which are irreversible. There's increased mucus production, fibrosis, and neovascularization. So ultimately, the airway is remodeled and there is lung dysfunction if you don't treat asthma well. Again, you can see this is chronic asthma with airway remodeling. There's fibrosis of the wall, inflammatory cells are present, muscle thickness is increased, and there is increased mucus. So a word on exercise-induced asthma. In exercise-induced asthma, asthma occurs after strenuous exercise. And it occurs characteristically after 3 to 8 minutes of exertion. Now coming to the symptoms of asthma. So what is the most common symptom of asthma in children? First of all, there is cough. This cough is typically an intermittent dry cough. Then there is expiratory wheezing, which is a whistling sound heard while breathing. In older children, you can also get breathlessness or dyspnea. In older children, you can also get tightness of the chest or congestion. Young children can also complain of intermittent non-focal chest pain. Now, what is important is that these respiratory symptoms get worse at night. They are associated with sleep and they are triggered by respiratory infections or inhalant allergens. The symptoms can be induced by exercise. It increases with exercise. By laughing, with crying, the symptoms increase. So how do you diagnose a case of asthma? The 4 key important points in diagnosis of asthma is history taking, physical examination, measurements of lung function, and trial use of asthma medications. History taking. So first is history taking, the most important part in making the diagnosis of any disease. So what will you ask to the parents? You'll ask, does your child have wheezing? Does your child wake up at the night due to coughing or due to breathing difficulty? Is there any interruption of activity, like the child stops running or plays less hard because of coughing, wheezing, shortness of breath? You also have to ask for cough or wheezing while laughing, while crying, when exposed to smoke or pets. You can also ask for history of any atopy like eczema, atopic dermatitis, food allergy. You have to look for any family history, and after that, history of any risk factors, history of any comorbidities. So you you can gather a lot of information by history. Then in physical examination, you have to look for wheezing. You can look for prolonged expiration. You also have to look for signs of increased work of breathing and signs of atopy, like conjunctivitis, atopic dermatitis, eczema. Now you must remember that chest examination may be normal in a patient who is coming to you in your OPD with asthma, because he may not have an exacerbation at that time. So the next is measurements of lung function, which we'll go in detail in this further. Okay, so what are the laboratory findings or the investigations you have to do in a patient suspected of asthma? The first is pulmonary function test, then bronchodilator response, exercise challenge test, exhaled nitric oxide, chest radiograph, and test for allergen sensitization. The first is pulmonary function testing. So this is used for diagnosing and monitoring asthma and in assessing the efficacy of therapy. It measures airflow and lung volumes during forced expiratory maneuvers. So it gives you an objective measure of airflow limitation. The two methods of pulmonary function testing, the most important is spirometry, of course, and another is peak flow meter, which is a handy way of measuring the pulmonary function. So how do you assess airway inflammation? In spirometry, what do you look for? The first thing is you look for airflow limitation. In spirometry, we measure forced expiratory airflow. Patient should perform a full, forceful and prolonged expiration. The most important characteristics which are studied are FEV1 and FVC. FEV1, it is the forced expiratory volume in the first second of expiration. Means when you ask a patient to do a full expiration, you measure the volume of gas, volume of air exhaled in the first second, and that gives you FEV1. Forced vital capacity, FVC, it is the total volume of air exhaled or the total lung volume. So in asthma, we get a low FEV1 and a ratio of FEV1 upon FVC less than 0.8. So basically, you get an idea that FEV1 or the volume of air exhaled in the first second is impaired in asthma. FVC remains approximately normal, so the ratio is decreased. Next, we assess the bronchodilator response, which assesses the reversibility of airflow limitation. So you remember, in asthma, there is reversible airflow obstruction, as I told you. So we have to see for evidence of reversibility of expiratory airflow limitation. So reversibility, how do you determine it? You measure FEV1 before and after inhalation of a short-acting beta agonist. And if there is increase in FEV1 more than 12%, it gives you a positive test. The next is, by giving an exercise challenge, we can look for worsening of FEV1 more than 15%. We can also look for a diurnal variation, morning to evening variation of FEV1. If it is more than 20%, it is a positive test. Now there's something called as exhaled nitric oxide. This exhaled nitric oxide basically tells you about eosinophilic inflammation. So a value of more than 20 parts per billion supports the clinical diagnosis of asthma in children. This is a peak flow meter. It is a very handy, inexpensive tool to measure the airflow. It is used for diagnosis and monitoring of asthma. So you have to give one hard, fast blow, one full expiration in this machine. Three readings you have to take, and the best of three is taken. You can use it for daily monitoring, for morning and evening. You can look for diurnal variation, It is a very handy tool for the patients. You can use it at home itself. Always remember, absence of symptoms at the time of examination does not include the diagnosis of asthma. Now coming to the treatment. So what all have we covered? We have covered the definition of asthma, the etiopathogenesis of asthma, what are the triggers which can set off an attack of asthma, what are the signs and symptoms of asthma, how do you diagnose asthma. Okay, so till the diagnosis part, I hope it's clear to all of you. Now coming to the treatment. The treatment or the management of asthma, there are four P's of management. First is the patient education. Second is pharmacotherapy. Third is prevention of triggers. And fourth is peak flow monitoring. So first, patient education. Patient education, this part of management is as important as any other step. You have to educate your patient at every visit. And what is it all about? You have to specify the goals of the treatment. You have to explain the basic pathophysiology of disease, because you have to explain that chronic inflammation and airway hyperresponsiveness, this underlie a clinically intermittent presentation. So the patient should know that only taking intermittent treatment just when he has symptoms is not necessary. So you have to explain the basic pathophysiology of the disease. You have to teach how to decrease the environmental exposures. You have to give a written asthma action plan to every patient, how to act at home if he has an exacerbation, the need of regular follow-up visits, lung function monitoring at home by peak flow meter. All this you have to explain to your patient. You have to educate your patient at every visit. You also have to tell about the adverse effects of the medication. Now, pharmacotherapy is of course the medicines which you are using, and we'll study in detail about this. So the drug treatment of asthma is basically two types of drugs are used. First is the relievers and the second is the controllers or preventers. The relievers are usually short acting drugs which act fast, the onset of action is fast, and they quickly relieve the symptoms. They usually are bronchodilators. Controllers are usually anti-inflammatory drugs which with or without bronchodilatory action. So these drugs, they prevent asthma attacks or exacerbations. They take some time to act, but they are long acting and they are a must of every asthma treatment plan. Some examples of the relievers. Relievers are basically SABAs, short acting beta 2 agonists. I'll use the word SABA in the rest of my presentation. So you should remember SABAs, salbutamol, levosalbutamol, they are anticholinergics, ipratropium bromide, xanthines, theophylline used very rarely, and yes, of course, subcutaneous adrenaline. Now the preventers or controllers, they are basically corticosteroids. First is prednisolone, which is taken orally. Rest all are inhaled corticosteroids, betamethasone, beclomethasone, budesonide and fluticasone. This constitutes the most important part of the management, so you should know this very clearly. Then there are xanthines like theophylline, they're mast cell stabilizers, sodium chromoglycate and nidocromil. They're long-acting beta agonists like bambutrol, salmeterol, formoterol. And then there are anti-leukotrienes, montelukast and zofilukast. Apart from this, we can have inhaled corticosteroids and long-acting beta agonists as a combination. And this is, in fact, a very important combination, as I'll tell you later on. So these preventers are to be taken regularly, irrespective of the symptoms. It is now well accepted that asthma is an inflammatory disease of the airways. So the basic pathology is inflammation of the airways, and that this bronchoconstriction, which gives rise to dyspnea, is just a sequelae to the inflammatory process. The basic process is the inflammation, and as a result of that inflammation, there is airway hyperresponsiveness. This results in bronchospasm when exposed to certain allergens. So asthma management is aimed at reducing airway inflammation. Less inflammation leads to better asthma control, fewer exacerbations, and decreased need for reliever medications. So now it is no longer considered sufficient to treat the episodes of respiratory distress when they occur with relievers only, even in the mild cases. So there's a shift in the focus of treatment from bronchodilators to anti-inflammatory drugs. What is the story of asthma treatment? This is a normal bronchial tree, an asthmatic bronchial tree, and this happens when you give the relievers, the SABAs. The bronchoconstriction is relieved, but the airway damages keep on occurring. And this can be controlled by giving regular controllers. So see, this part is reversible. If you do not give controllers, these airways again shift back to the abnormal ones. So controllers are important. They can only get your airways back to normal. So this is to emphasize the GINA recommendations for mild asthma. These are the changes which have occurred. They stress that only SABAs used to relieve asthmatic attacks are not sufficient. For safety, GINA no longer recommends starting with SABA only treatment. GINA recommends that all adults and adolescents with asthma should receive inhaled corticosteroids containing controller treatment to reduce their risk of serious exacerbation and to control the symptoms. GINA is a global initiative for asthma. It is a worldwide authority who gives recommendations for asthma. So now SABA, it is proven that SABA only treatment is associated with increased risk of exacerbations and lower lung function. What are the benefits of inhaled corticosteroids? They reduce the asthma symptoms, they reduce the airway hyperresponsiveness, they reduce the use of rescue medications, that is SABAs, improves the quality of life, reduces the need for short course of oral steroids, systemic steroids, which are harmful, and reduces the emergency room visits and hospitalization by 50%. So when we study about the benefits, let us also study about the adverse effects of inhaled corticosteroids, which are in fact very few, and they are most commonly local side effects. These are candidiasis, oral candidiasis, and dysphonia. So oral candidiasis is due to deposition of this steroids in the oral mucosa, and it can be avoided by the use of spacer with inhaled MDIs to avoid oropharyngeal deposition. It can also be reduced by mouth rinsing after taking inhaled corticosteroids, called as the swish and spit technique. Same with dysphonia, we have to practice these precautions and these adverse effects can be reduced greatly. Sometimes there can be systemic side effects, which are very rare. It occurs only when you are consuming inhaled corticosteroids in very high doses, more than 1000 micrograms per day, and frequently, very frequently, that is more than 4 times a day. So these are very rare. Now what is combination therapy? As I told you, that two drugs, inhaled corticosteroids and long-acting beta agonists, are combined in one inhaler so that they can be taken simultaneously. There is synergy between these two drugs, and in one combination they are very useful, and as of recently, GINA recommends that a long-acting beta agonist, that is formoterol, it has to be used in combination with inhaled corticosteroids as a reliever also. Now what is special about formoterol is that, being a long-acting beta agonist, it has a long-lasting action, plus it has a rapid onset of action. So it acts rapidly also, it can relieve an attack rapidly, and it has long-acting action also. So you have to use formoterol in combination with ICS in every case in adults and adolescents, for as a reliever medication also. These are the available combinations. certain drugs, you should know what are these. Very commonly used drugs, fluticasone, it is an inhaled corticosteroid, budesonide, inhaled corticosteroids. Then there are some combinations with formoterol, salmeterol and Tiotropium is a long-acting anticholinergic. Levosalbutamol and salbutamol, as I told, are SABAs, and ipratropium is a anticholinergic. So these anti-asthma drugs can be administered by three routes: oral, inhaled and injections. Oral are available in the form of tablets and syrups. Inhaled mode of administration is very important. This you should know properly and it has a value in your practical exams also. There are three types of inhaled modalities available. First is metered dose inhalers or MDIs, DPIs or dry powder inhalers, and nebulizers. This is the most important mode of administration of corticosteroids in asthma. The third is parenteral or by injections. So you should keep in mind that all asthma drugs should ideally be taken to the inhaled route. Why inhaled route? Because smaller doses, since inhaled by inhaled route, you are giving the drug locally. So small amounts of drugs are required, and these small amounts of drugs, they attain high local concentration. So the efficacy is more. Plus, since you are giving small doses, it does not reach the systemic circulation. The systemic concentration is very less. So there is safety. The systemic side effects are reduced largely. So inhaled route has a rapid action, less amount of drug is used, it is very well tolerated, and it is the treatment of choice in acute symptoms. As I told you earlier also, what are the modes of inhaled treatment? What are the aerosol delivery systems currently available? Metered dose inhalers, dry powder inhalers, spacers. Spacers are used with MDIs, they are not used independently. And there are nebulizers. So look at these carefully, you'll get this in your table viva also. The first one is the DPIs. This is a DPI. This is an MDI inhaler. This is a spacer. All these are spacers. This is also a spacer. This is also a spacer. So you attach, look at this picture. You attach the spacer into an MDI and then it can be taken. What are the advantages of the spacer? I'll tell you. So no coordination is required when you're using a spacer. When you are using an MDI alone, you have to have a coordination between pushing the MDI and inhaling. So there has to be coordination between pushing the MDI and inhalation. When you use a spacer, this coordination is not required. There is reduced oropharyngeal deposition, so reduced chances of adverse effects of candidiasis, dysphonia. There is increased drug deposition in the lungs, so it leads to overall greater efficacy of the drug. So roughly in less than 6 years of patient, you have to use a pressurized MDI with a spacer with a mask. Like this, mask, spacer with MDI. In more than 6 years, you have to use spacer with an MDI. So you always have to use a spacer, keep that in mind. You can also use DPIs in patient more than 6 years of age. Nebulizers may be required in patient less than 3 years of age, who cannot have a coordination, who cannot use these things. A nebulizer may be required. So use any spacer, but always use a spacer. Just to look at the newer therapies, there are some newer therapies which are coming. The first one is the biological therapy, anti-IgE, omalizumab, anti-IL-5, anti-IL-5 receptor, mepolizumab. Even if you don't remember their names, it's not important. Just a brief briefing of this, anti-interleukin 4 receptor dopilumab. A word about allergen immunotherapy. Allergen immunotherapy is a new thing and very effective modality of treatment available nowadays. So it is, what is allergen immunotherapy? In this, you administer gradually increasing doses of the allergen itself to which the patient is sensitive. So you administer gradually increasing doses to reduce the patient's allergic response to those allergens. So patient gradually becomes tolerant to that, and when he's exposed to that, he doesn't develop an attack. If administered properly, it is very safe, very effective. They're usually giving subcutaneously. What are the goals of asthma treatment? So the goals of asthma treatment are symptom control and risk reduction. Both of them are very important. Symptom control means the patient gets less of the symptoms, there is no disturbance of sleep, there is no exercise limitation, and risk reduction means reduction of exacerbations, reduction of asthma related deaths, reduction of the side effects of medication, and maintaining an overall normal lung function. So this is the asthma management cycle of shared decision making. This asthma management cycle is given by Gina to minimize the risk and control the symptoms. So if you see this, you'll know that asthma management involves a continuous cycle to assess, to adjust the treatment, and to review the response to your treatment. What do you assess? When a patient comes to you, at every visit, you assess his symptoms, how are they controlled, you assess the risk factors, the inhaler techniques, the patient preferences. In treatment, of course, the first is medications. So you always have to give inhaled corticosteroids containing controller management to all patients. Then there are treatment of risk factors, if they are modifiable, use of non-pharmacological therapies and strategies as appropriate, and training of patient in essential skills and guided asthma self-management. You have to review the response, you have to review the symptoms, the exacerbations, whether they are occurring or not, the side effects, the lung function, and the patient satisfaction. Okay, so before telling you the steps of asthma management, we should know, what is asthma severity? How do you grade the severity of asthma? So asthma severity is basically the intrinsic intensity of the disease. And assessment is generally done most accurately in patients who are not receiving controller therapy. So according to this, according to asthma severity, asthma is divided into two, intermittent and persistent. So intermittent, literal meaning also you're getting that the patient is getting the symptoms intermittently, very infrequently, and persistent, the symptoms are persistent. So what is the dividing line? So when do you call it persistent asthma? So in more than 5 years of age, if there are two exacerbations requiring oral corticosteroids in 1 year, then it is called as persistent asthma. In a patient less than 5 years, if there are more than 4 wheezing episodes per year, each episode lasting for more than 1 day, plus their presence of risk factors for persistent asthma. If you remember, I told you risk factors for persistent asthma, mainly history of asthma in parents, history of any atopy. So if any of these is present, or more than 2 exacerbations in 6 months, which require systemic corticosteroids. Okay, so in less than 5 years, more than 2 exacerbations in 1 year, and in less than 5 years, 2 exacerbations in 6 months requiring systemic steroids, or more than four wheezing episodes per year, and risk factors. So you have classified as intermittent and persistent. Now in persistent, the severity can be mild, moderate, or severe. So classically, we used to divide this on the severity basis, mild, moderate, and severe. So mild, when the symptoms are more than once a week but not daily. In moderate, symptoms are daily. And in severe, the symptoms are daily plus they are present throughout the day.
there is limitation of physical activities. Now, a new classification of asthma severity has also come, in which asthma severity is decided on the basis of lowest level of treatment required to achieve best control. Okay, so the minimum treatment required to achieve the best control, that's how you can classify asthma. So if only SABAs are needed, it's intermittent asthma. If low dose daily inhaled corticosteroids or leukotriene receptor antagonists are required, it is mild asthma. Low to moderate dose ICS or ICS plus LABA in low doses daily, it is moderate asthma. If high doses of ICS plus minus LABA plus minus oral corticosteroids and other treatment, it is severe asthma. So now coming to this flowchart of the step-wise management of asthma, this is very important. Every one of you should know there are 5 steps in the management of asthma. So first we will discuss the category of adolescents more than 12 years and adults. So 5 steps in asthma management. In all the steps you should know what is the preferred controller and what is the preferred reliever. So see, in first step there is as needed low dose ICS for metrol. Okay, so the step 1 is as needed low dose ICS for metrol. So when do you give step 1 treatment? If the patient is having intermittent asthma, there is symptoms less than twice a month, you have to give as needed low dose ICS for metrol, which is acting as a reliever also. The step 2 is for mild persistent asthma, means symptoms are more than twice a month but they are less than daily. In this you have to give daily low dose inhaled corticosteroids. And as reliever, you have to give ICS formoterol combination. So as a controller you are using daily low dose inhaled corticosteroids, and as a reliever you are using this combination of ICS formoterol. In the step 3 you have to use low dose combination of ICS LABA, and as a reliever you again have to use ICS formoterol combination SOS as and when required. In step 4 there is medium dose ICS LABA, medium dose ICS LABA combination, and as a reliever again you give ICS formoterol SOS. If the patient is not controlled with medium dose, you shift the patient to step 5 treatment, which is high dose ICS LABA. Okay, and then in this step you also have to consider alternative therapies like oral corticosteroids, biological therapies if the patient is not being controlled at a lower step. So what do you get in this? If the patient is having intermittent asthma, you start step 1 treatment. If the patient is having mild persistent asthma, you directly start from step 2, that is you have to give a low dose inhaled corticosteroid regularly, daily. If the patient is having moderate persistent asthma or severe persistent asthma, we usually start with step 3 treatment, means we have to give a combination ICS LABA low dose, and if the patient is not improving you have to start with step 4 or step 5 treatment as required. So this slide shows you the controller treatment, means the treatment taken to prevent exacerbations, it has to be taken regularly. In step 1, as needed. In step 2, see, daily low dose inhaled corticosteroids. Step 3, LTRA. Step 4 is medium dose and step 5 is high dose. Now, how is it different from management in children 6 to 11 years of age? In children 6 to 11 years of age, combination ICS formoterol is not recommended or is not the preferred treatment as reliever as in adolescents. In this, what Gina recommends is that in step 1, you have to take SABAs as reliever when necessary, but additionally, whenever you are taking SABA, you have to give low dose ICS along with it. Means SABA only treatment is now not recommended at any step, even in children 6 to 11 years of age. So in this, the reliever is SABA, of course, but whenever you are giving SABA, you have to give a shot of ICS also. In step 2, you have to give daily low dose inhaled corticosteroids, and as a reliever, you can use SABA. In step 3, low dose combination comes. So the combination comes into picture in step 3, ICS LABA combination, or you have to increase the dose of ICS, medium dose ICS. So either medium dose ICS or low dose SABA. In step 4, there is medium dose combination. Medium dose combination. And in step 5, you have to refer the patient, you have to give add-on therapies as the patient is not improving. Step 4, medium dose ICS LABA. Step 3 is low dose. Step 2 is daily low dose inhaled corticosteroids. And step 1 is, in this, the important thing is that whenever you take SABA SOS, you have to give ICS. So at each step, you have to remember that you have to do parent and patient education. You have to teach them about controlling the environmental exposures and treating the comorbidities. In patients more than 5 years, consider subcutaneous allergen immunotherapy for allergic asthma. Now you have started giving the treatment to the patient. Now, how do you assess if the patient's symptoms are getting controlled or not? So, how do you assess the symptom control? So, you have to look for the symptom control in the past 4 weeks. There are 4 points, very important. The daytime symptoms, any activity limitation, how much is the reliever medication needed, and any night symptoms. So, if daytime symptoms are more than once a week, is there any activity limitation? The child plays less, he runs less, he easily tires. Then if the reliever medication need is more than once a week, and if there is any night symptoms, if the answer to any of these questions is yes, you have to calculate how many yes are there. So if there is no yes, none of these is yes, the asthma is well controlled. If answer to one to two of these questions is yes, then it is partly controlled. And if 3 to 4 questions are yes, then it is uncontrolled. So what do you do in these cases if there is partly controlled or uncontrolled? So if they're not controlled properly, you have to step up the treatment. So if you're giving step 2 treatment, you have to give step up to step 3. Okay. And if the symptoms are well controlled, you have to continue this treatment for at least 3 months. And if the patient is well in these 3 months, you can think of stepping down the treatment. Means you can reduce the treatment. Do not stop altogether. You can decrease the treatment. So stepping up. How do you step up the asthma treatment? You can step up for at least, you have to step up for at least 2 to 3 months if the symptoms persist despite 2 to 3 months of controller treatment. However, before stepping up, you have to look essentially if the inhaler technique is correct, if the adherence is good, if the risk factors which can be modified, they are present, or any comorbid conditions. You have to look for this. You can consider stepping down once good control has been achieved and maintained for 3 months. So, stepping down is for finding the lowest treatment that can control both symptoms, exacerbations, and minimizing the side effects of medications. So this is how partly controlled and uncontrolled, you step up the treatment. If controlled, you can reduce after maintaining good control for 3 months. Now, I hope the asthma management part is clear to all of you. Now we come to asthma exacerbation. So what if there is an asthma exacerbation? What is asthma exacerbation? There are acute or subacute episodes of progressively worsening symptoms and airflow obstruction. And a severe exacerbation that does not improve with standard therapy is called as status asthmaticus. So when a patient comes to you in acute asthma, how do you grade the severity? So you have to look for the symptoms. The patient is breathless. So he's breathless while walking only or at rest only. How does he talk? He talks in full sentences or he's gasping. He cannot speak full sentences. He's speaking just phrases or just words. You have to look for the alertness of the patient. Then in signs, you have to look for signs of accessory muscles working, signs of distress, the pulse rate, the respiratory rate, the presence of bronchi, the saturation of the patient, and the peak expiratory flow rate. So you can go through this table to grade the severity of acute asthma. This is also a table you can refer to. So how do you manage the asthma exacerbations? So first of all, you assess the patient. If he is mild or moderate, if the severity is mild or moderate, you have to start the treatment by giving SABAs, 4 to 10 puffs of SABAs by MDI plus spacer. And you can repeat it every 20 minutes for 1 hour. You can also give prednisolone orally and you can also give controlled oxygen. But however, if the asthma attack is severe, you directly have to admit the patient, start SABAs. So in mild acute asthma, okay, the first thing you have to remember is all asthma patients should have a written asthma action plan. What is an asthma action plan? They should have a written plan that if there is an exacerbation at home, what do they have to do? So they should know how to give home treatment. They should start administering themselves SABAs. So SABAs have to be given 4 to 10 puffs, MDI plus spacer every 20 minutes for first hour. If the patient is improving, then you can send the patient home on oral or in inhalational therapy 6 to 8 hourly. However, if it's not improving, then you have to treat it as moderate asthma. In moderate and severe, your first step is to give beta agonist by nebulizer. Or MDI plus spacer is also equally efficient. You have to repeat it every 20 minutes. You have to start oral prednisolone in a dose of 1 to 2 mg per kg for about 3 to 5 days. You have to give supplemental oxygen. If he is improving, increase the interval between the drugs. And you can stop the oxygen also if saturation is normal. But if he is not improving, you can add ipratropium every 6 hourly. It's an anticholinergic. Ipratropium inhalation. You can add every 6 hourly. You can also give injection hydrocort intravenously. Now, what is the treatment of life-threatening asthma? First step, you have to start supplemental oxygen. Give beta-2 agonist plus with or without ipratropium by nebulizer. You can also give a continuous nebulization of SABAs in this case. You can give subcutaneous adrenaline or terbutaline, IV hydrocortisone. Supportive care has to be continued. You have to very wisely monitor and give the IV fluids. You have to watch for electrolytes and any acidosis, hypoxemia which is developing. If the patient is improving with this, you can give 4 to 6 hourly nebulization and oral steroids continued for 5 days. But if he is not improving, the other modalities of treatment which are available are injection magnesium sulfate, injection theophylline. If not improving with all this also, you may have to consider invasive ventilation. So I hope you're clear. Now a word I want at this time, I do want to tell you about what are the changes in asthma management in the era of COVID-19. So you should remember that children with asthma should continue all of their inhaled medications, including the inhaled corticosteroids as prescribed. It does not have to be changed. However, nebulizer should be avoided. Why do you avoid nebulizers? Because they are aerosol generating procedures and high risk of transmission is there. So nebulizers should be avoided. MDIs are preferred. MDI via a spacer is the most preferred treatment during severe attacks. spacer should not be shared at home. Biological therapy should be used in severe asthma patients who qualify for them in order to limit the need of oral corticosteroids as much as possible. So here I end with my lecture. Thank you. Stay home, stay safe.